Welcome back to Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we're having the great pleasure of speaking with Keri-Lynn Wilson. Returning to where we left off, sort of, are there times today when you conduct and you think, oh, I wish I would have known that 20 years ago when I started out?
No.
No.
I'm not that hard on myself.
You're not? Good.
I'm terribly hard on myself, but for things that, that are a natural part of growing as a musician, you can't look back, and I tend not to look back, just in general. I like to look forward. I have a lot of hope and aspirations about the future, so I never look back, no.
Great. But would you
in
look back?
In a healthy way? In a healthy way, I'll take things I've done or see a score that from 20 years ago I thought, oh, how could I have done that? Yeah. But it's all part of the learning process.
Sure. Looking back to right after graduating from Juilliard, what did a big break come along for you, or how did things get started?
Yeah. So the first was being fortunate enough to have a job right out of school. I was accepted as the associate conductor of the Dallas Symphony. Mm-hmm. So I stayed there for 4 years. That was an incredible experience.
Assistant to whom?
It was Andrew Litton, who had just started as well as music director. So I spent 4 years, and in those 4 years, I started doing guest conducting, and I had one fantastic invitation, which came from an impresario in Italy. Mm. He's Mario Draghi. He had been organizing these galas. There was one in particular at the Vatican, and it would include José Carreras, it would include Daniela Dessy, a bunch of wonderful singers. I had never conducted an opera. I had been very symphonically focused, if that's a word. My upbringing barely touched on opera. I had a tendency to be a symphonic snob. My sister was a singer. I never went to opera. So it was just after graduating at Juilliard, I'd gone to opera performances as a student at Juilliard, and once I started in the conducting program, I started becoming much more, of course, educated in opera. I took courses on Verdi and Wagner at the Juilliard School. But anyway, so I was invited to this concert, and it had famous Italian opera arias, and so I learned them. I did this concert, wonderful, in the Vatican, very memorable. And at that point, I was asked if I'd like to do my first opera, Lucia di Lammermoor, in Verona. Mm-hmm. Lion's Den. Wow. I couldn't sing you a tune from Lucia. I said, of course I'll do it. Said 6 months, I learned Lucia. I went there. I guess I had some success. Then I went and did a Tosca in the Opera de Nice. And then I was invited for Tosca back at the Arena di Verona. So it's kind of started snowballing. And suddenly I was doing so much opera, and especially in Italy because of this wonderful impresario. So I had a lot of luck in terms of that and career-wise, but I think I began really loving opera. I listened to every recording of Lucia before, of course, I had to conduct. I knew everybody's interpretation because the fear of being in the lion's den of Italy, you know, so I wasn't stupid in that way. I was definitely courageous, perhaps. But anyway, that was my first venture in opera. So it was in those years as an assistant or an associate at the Dallas Symphony, I started doing opera and started getting engagements outside, and that's when I left.
When they ask you the first, to do the opera, the first, you say 6 months. What did you do in that 6 months besides memorize?
I got some advice as to where I should do some cuts in Lucia. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. I asked a conductor, a colleague, I said, should I sing the recitativos in the first orchestra reading? He said, yes. So, of course, I was freshening up on my Italian, which was, at that point,
not an easy thing to do in front of an Italian orchestra.
But I'll never forget the first, now that we're talking about it, the first rehearsal with just the piano with the soloists in the duet with the tenor and the baritone, we came to the cadenza, and they said, how would you like it? I said, as you like it. I had no idea what to advise them.
Yeah. So they were probably happy to hear that instead of being dictated.
No, they really wanted me to tell them.
So you feel that 6 months really said, okay, I'm ready for it.
I can definitely learn an opera in 6 months, I said to myself. But you have to start somewhere.
Right. that is very true. Right. And it's very different, you know, doing symphonic. And singing.
So you
have to combine those two together, but in the same time, you have to breathe with them.
Yes.
All these things,
yes.
What do you do in the first time?
Exactly that. You breathe with them, you sing with them. That has been my technique for up until today. I mean, if I don't, I have to know the words by memory, I have to know the opera by memory,
sure.
But, and also to absolutely be in sync with the singer so that when they do take that unexpected breath, so they do something spontaneous, that I'm ready to respond. That's what a great opera conductor would do. So it, of course, took years of experience to get it in my blood, and I feel that now it's very comfortable. For example, I could step in and just do a poem anywhere because it's just something. You have the technique at that point after many years of doing it, and you're so agile once you do a lot of opera. It, yeah, it feels good. It's always dangerous and it's always a roller coaster ride every opera performance. But that's the fun. I like the risk and the challenge of that.
Is there more roller coaster in opera than there is in symphonic?
Absolutely.
For sure. There's too many, there are more unknowns.
How so?
I always say, you know, what you do in rehearsal is what you get in performance with symphonic. You know, you have a set amount of rehearsals, the package is prepared, and then we deliver it.
You let it fly.
Yeah. And it's always in performance that it's so much better because we feel the audience behind you, and it's just this, at least for me. I love performing because it's so much more electric. Hopefully you're no longer thinking. It's just more of a zen kind of feel. Whereas in opera, everything, perfect story. I mean, I'll do a new production, Carmen at the Royal Opera House. It was a very complicated revival. Berejkovsky. And the staging was very complex. This is only last year, so it's very fresh in my mind. The staging is very complex. We had a whole month of staging rehearsals. Of course, the last week is just with orchestra. The dress rehearsal, the Carmen, she canceled. We had somebody come in for the dress. No, she sang the dress. We had somebody come in for the premiere. Completely new. The orchestra had never heard her. I had never worked with her. Then we had 8 performances. We went through 5 Carmens.
Oh, wow.
We had to fly in different Carmens. So even if you've rehearsed for a month, everything will change in the performance. So that's, you know, it's terribly frustrating when the whole company has worked really hard. For example, if it's a new production. Like I once did a Fanciulla, and the singer got sick for the premiere. So they flew in, somebody was over the transatlantic, she came in. She, poor thing, she had done Fanciulla. She was the only one we could get. She had done it about 2 years ago. I mouthed the entire, we had no souffleur, that was not part of the show. I mouthed the entire show for her. Literally, I was multitasking. Anyway, I mean, that's opera.
Yeah, it is opera.
Aggravating.
Quick question about souffleur that you mentioned it. Do you prefer to conduct an opera with or without?
Absolutely without. I'd prefer that the singer is prepared and they watch me instead of a souffleur. I mean, because that's what I do. I sing with them. And for those who look in the box in the front, if I'm doing that, then it's out of sync. Yeah.
You have a very wide range of repertoire, both in symphony and in opera. Is there any time period or genre that you say, no, that's not for me. I just leave that to others. What would that be?
Baroque.
Baroque.
Baroque, oh. Absolutely. It's, first of all, I feel that if, I mean, I love it, but if I were to do it, I would rehearse and then let them play for the performance. I don't think it needs a conductor. You could probably say that of a lot of early classical, but I think there's a lot of academic work that also goes into that. You have to do a lot of preparation, analysis of, well, like a Mozart symphony. I love the challenge, and it's incredibly demanding from a conductor to prepare the parts to make sure that you have everything is understood, because there's only so much you can do in your gestures, but incredible balancing all that stuff. It's a stylistically very challenging, but I do Mozart.
You do Mozart.
I do.
And you do bel canto. You do early.
Yep, I did a lot of bel canto. But today, if I'm asked, would you like to do a Donizetti opera or a Tchaikovsky opera? I've kind of put the bel canto in my past a little now, because for two reasons. I like to grow as an artist in terms of repertoire. I like new things. I did a Cenerentola, and I said, no, I don't need to do that again. It's not one of my favorites. Life is short, and there is so much repertoire that I haven't explored yet, such as My First String, I'm dying to do. Hopefully that's coming soon. But that's one reason. The other reason is my own, and it's a selfish reason, my own personal satisfaction in performance. I love the sound and the involvement with the orchestra. And if it's at the mercy of a singer who you never worked with, who flew in for the last, that's not challenging for me. And it's not as exhilarating as if I do a Pique Dame or Shostakovich's Macbeth. I mean, that is the stuff that makes my blood boil. And at this stage, I really am addicted to things that make my blood boil. I have so much passion that I like to give in performance, and waking up every day, if I'm not stimulated with that repertoire, it's all about repertoire for me. Working with great artists.
We can see that. I think probably in the early stage of your career, anything, you know, you will do it, but now,
yes,
you can choose.
Now I can
yes
choose.
Or no.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You have a great affinity for Russian literature, music. When did this start?
It actually started very, very early, because my grandmother, the other one who is still alive, the other, she's 99.7,
wow.
9.10 out of 12 months. She's Ukrainian. And her mother, so my great-grandmother, when I was a child, they only spoke in Ukrainian. I grew up hearing Ukrainian. I was fascinated by Russia. And I was very, I don't know what it is, because I didn't have many Russian friends as a child. I think perhaps television, the music, I was very much fascinated by it. And I really wanted to learn Russian at some point, I thought, because I just loved it, the sound of it. But it wasn't until I started conducting at the Marinsky about 15 years ago, almost a little less. First of all, I was thrilled to be there and work with these great musicians. And I also realized very soon that I had to speak Russian in order to communicate or have a future at that opera house, because the process of being given one orchestral rehearsal, stage and orchestra, you have to communicate right. Very quickly. Right. So you are extremely handicapped if you can't speak the language. So it came out of necessity at one point. And so I said, I'm getting myself a tutor. And I started working with a tutor who is Russian, who lives here in New York. She became my best friend. I learned the language. We constantly speak. I read every day in Russian. I write every day in Russian. I'm infatuated by Russian art, poetry,
by literature,
everything. And I've gone through several stages in life of, anyway, that's getting off topic. But Russia is, I think, what speaks closest to me. The Russian language, the music, all of that, it goes deep into my soul, and I feel like I can relate to it the most. Mm-hmm. And also now that I work as a regular conductor at the Bolshoi, it's constantly improving, and it's...
When you go to Mariinsky or Bolshoi, well, from the beginning, did they allow you to conduct the big Russian pieces, or were you there to conduct more European opera?
Yeah, I was known as an Italian opera conductor at that point, or French or German, but I did. I started with the Italian repertoire, but then they gave me an Yolanta, Tchaikovsky's Yolanta, which they do traditionally every Christmas for the children. So I loved doing that. That was wonderful. And
what did they ask you? Can you do this piece?
They just said, do you want to? Because they knew I spoke Russian.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
For that reason. Yes, of course.
Yeah.
What is your favorite piece?
Can't say, but I have a few. You mean Russian?
Yes, yes.
I adore Boris Godunov.
Oh, sure.
Eugenia Onegin, Pikovaya Dama, Lady Macbeth of Mtsensk, Shostakovich. Shostakovich symphonies are my real passion as well.
When is going to be next time for you to go there?
Next, I've just discussed Epic Dam in Latvia. They're doing a new production. So I said I would absolutely love to return to that. Yeah. Whenever I'm asked now what kind of repertoire, I say, give me anything Russian or Wagner, because I want to do much more Wagner. I love Wagner.
What have you done? I know you want to do The Ring. What have you done?
Minor.
Minor.
I've done Fliegende Holländer, several places, and Tannhäuser. Yeah. But that's it.
When you travel like this, how do you feel? I mean, constantly.
You know, I've been doing it. I was asked that. What's it like traveling? Don't you get tired? How's your jet lag? It's c'est la vie. That is my life. I've been doing it for 20 years. That is what I know and love. Of course, the jet lag is tough. But I have certain things that I do for my sanity, mental and physical. I keep myself in extremely good shape. I'm very athletic. I swim every day. Ah, I work out.
Good.
I eat very well. I sound like a saint.
That's the best.
No, I'm kidding. I drank. I love my wine. That's okay. That helps me relax. But I'm very disciplined, yeah. So music drives me. And as tired as I am or exhausted, I think most artists would tell you this. When you get on the stage, or the second you start working, you're re-energized. You're so driven, supported, and the adrenaline flows. So.
Now, do you have preference, symphonic or opera?
No, I have the preference to do both.
Make a good balance.
That's great.
The balance is very important to me, yes.
Do you care about the critics?
Do I care about the critics?
Be honest.
Nobody likes to hear bad things about themselves, but you learn to not...
To live with it.
To not... If I feel insecure about a performance, I especially will not look at the reviews. If I feel great about a performance, I'll especially not look at the reviews. You can't win.
Right.
Everybody has an opinion.
That's right.
Let the management say, here was a good review. Let them use that. But at this point, no. I think I take criticism better from a colleague, like an artist.
Yes.
Somebody from the orchestra, a singer. Yes, but not somebody who's sitting in the back who knows nothing about what's the preparation has been, for example. I mean, I was thinking, these performances that we do, and people don't know the history. They don't know that a singer came in at the last minute. There has been not one rehearsal.
Right.
They will right away write WR. You know, that impression of that performance. So is that fair?
Yeah.
So you have to go with the punches. That's the career of being an artist, the life of being an artist.
After a performance at night, can you turn it off and get
no.
a good night's sleep? Never. Still not.
And that's the problem with having a 9 o'clock a.m. flight, because you will never, I never sleep, no. It just goes over and over.
Especially the tempi that you thought were a little bit wrong.
Everything you want to,
but you remember the good things from a performance, of course.
And that too keeps you awake.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, the exhilaration, it's hard to come down. Yeah.
After all these years, did you find a way how to deal with your life the way you want it?
No, I'm never satisfied. I always want more. I'm always looking ahead.
That's very hard, though.
Always climbing. But that's what makes
exciting.
Me as a person. I think it's just the way I have an insatiable appetite for knowledge and for growing, for growth as a human being. I never look back. People ask that. They say, what did you think? How would you feel about that? I never look back. It's always striving for the next big step or what I want more of.
What opera is calling to you for the future besides The Ring that you just say, I must conduct this?
Absolutely. Everything that I haven't conducted, all of the...
Unless it's Baroque.
Right. Yeah. All of the Russian. I've done most of the great operas I consider I have to do those. But in terms of the ones I haven't done that I really want to do to become much more of a whole musician to keep growing are all the Wagners, all of the rest of the Russian, and of course symphonic. I haven't done Mahler 8 yet. I haven't done Mahler 2.
Oh,
those big forces, yeah.
You know, after so many years working here, and what would you say to the next generations? How do you bring in more, you know, conductor like yourself? How do you encourage them?
Only advice, I don't like to be a mentor. I don't like to teach that much, but I always say and try and encourage people, do what you love. Follow your passion. You have to feel passionate about something. You can't have doubts. People have to be encouraged to go for it. And that's something I never had to be told. It just is an inner drive. So if that would help or encourage people to future great artists, then that would be great.
You wish that a lot of people will have your personality and drive and that kind of convictions. But sometimes, you know, there are quite a few very talented people. They probably need some pushing, encouragement, or yeah, you're okay. You can do it.
Sure.
Yeah.
There's so many types of artists out there.
That's right.
I think conductors are a slightly different species. We have to be made out of steel and really go for it. You can't have self-doubting all the time. I mean, you can artistically, but as a person, you have to have those leadership skills and things, so you can't be taught those, I think.
Optimistically, a conductor usually has greater longevity than a singer. So you think of...
But I always, I say to my grandma's, Grandma, what did you do?
99 years old.
I said, yes, they never exercised. They never paid attention to what they ate. I thought, you know, I'm going to die tomorrow.
No.
But they love music. Yeah, I'm always singing, always keeping... Music makes us live longer, I'm convinced of that.
You have...
Hopefully
two 90 some years, you know, grandmother, and I think you have a good gene.
Yes. That's what I've been told, but I'm still convinced all this stress of a conductor, this crazy lifestyle, hopefully I'm okay.
Can you imagine how many more years you can conduct?
I know. Think of all the repertoire I could see.
Yes.
Yeah.
Good luck to you.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
On that note, we have to stop, but what a pleasure it's been speaking
with
you.
It's been such a pleasure. Thank you so much.
This has been Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we've had the great pleasure of speaking with Keri-Lynn Wilson.